Yes, we can hear her.
Can.
Yes.
Okay. I'd like to welcome one and all to this webinar this morning.
Ruth, we're not hearing you, Ruth.
Alistair, I am hearing Ruth.
I am hearing Ruth as well, Alistair.
Okay, go ahead, Ruth. It seems I'm the only one not hearing you. Go ahead. Sorry, apologies.
Okay. Welcome one and all to this special webinar this morning. It is indeed my pleasure to welcome all of the participants who are joining us on behalf of the Banrop Association in the Bahamas. This morning we have a very special program lined up for you. And we assure that at the end of the session, you would have gained much information on the different activities being conducted across the region. So we are excited to have all of you join us, and please feel free to enter your comments in the chat. We'll be following the chat to see what comments have been placed. And without any further ado, I will ask and introduce Ms. Shikara Lightburn, who is the acting representative, country representative for IECA in the Bahamas. And at this time, I will turn it over to Ms. Lightburn, who will bring the welcome remarks officially for you.
Good morning, one and all. Thank you very much for your brief introduction, Ms. Ruth Forbes. On behalf of the IECA office in the Bahamas, it is a great pleasure and privilege to be a part of this webinar that is hosted by CanROC and by extension, the Bahamas Network of Rural Women Producers in the Bahamas. This is a very timely webinar considering the challenges that we have had economically throughout the year in the Caribbean. I think this disease and this pandemic has brought us together more closely and have us to realize how important it is for us to work together and network. I think a lot of us have learned a lot of different skills, especially technologically in the use of Zoom and all these different platforms, and we've been forced to use technology, which is not necessarily a bad thing. So we have a long-standing relationship with CanROC and as well as Banrop, and we act as a secretariat for this women's group as well as the youth group, CAFI. So we want to continue our work with CanROC, and we hope that moving forward we could try to look for some more funding and better our outreach throughout the region and throughout the Bahamas, as well as the Caribbean. So I want to welcome you all throughout the region, from Suriname to Jamaica, Barbados, Trinidad, our brothers and sisters, mainly our sisters throughout the Caribbean. Thank you, and I just welcome you to this webinar, and I hope it's a very fruitful webinar, and hope we can get some good ideas out and some good questions out, and I look forward to the various presentations. So without further delay, I'll turn the lectern over back to Ms. Ruth Forbes so she can continue with our program.
Thank you so much, Ms. Lightburn, and I'm sure that you feel very welcome now, having heard from her. This morning, we are honored to have our distinguished patron with us, who will bring remarks shortly. But before she comes to us, I wish to introduce to you Mrs. Patricia Minnis, the spouse of the Prime Minister of the Commonwealth of the Bahamas. Mrs. Patricia Minnis holds an earned Bachelor of Science degree in biology from the prestigious Bethune-Cookman University. Upon graduating, she embarked on a teaching career at a local high school in Nassau, the Bahamas, where she developed a passion for youth development. Mrs. Minnis formerly served as the Assistant Director of Agriculture at the Ministry of Agriculture and Marine Resources in the Bahamas. Her career in agriculture and marine resources spans more than 30 years, and during her tenure, she was intricately involved in the establishment of the local food technology unit and the development of food policies throughout the Bahamas. Further, Mrs. Minnis' passion for advancing the industry led to a 2-year secondment at the Bureau of Standards in Jamaica. She is a former board member of the Bahamas Bureau of Standards and Quality and served as the contact person and delegate to the Codex Alimentarius Commission Food Code. Mrs. Minnis is an active member of the Spouses of CARICOM Leaders Association. As a member of this association, she works alongside other first ladies, spouses of heads of government, and UN representatives to facilitate knowledge exchange, which contributes positively to progress in key areas such as mental health, the reduction of gender-based violence, teenage pregnancy, HIV, and AIDS. Currently, Mrs. Minnis spearheads the work of the Office of the Spouse of the Prime Minister in the Bahamas. The establishment of the office was based upon a CARICOM decision in fulfilling mandate for support of women and advancement of special initiatives, including the United Nations 2030 Sustainable Development Goals. The office is a nonpartisan office that was officially launched on March 21st, 2018. To date, the office has partnered with several organizations in advancing this mandate. In parallel with these partnerships, the office has launched several of its own initiatives to address national issues of importance. These include issues relative to health, wellness, gender-based violence and education, and the empowerment of women and adolescent girls. As an executive member of SCLAN, Mrs. Minnis is also committed to working with the first ladies and spouses of heads of governments of the Caribbean community to champion CARIWAC initiative. Further, Mrs. Minnis is a motivational speaker and delivers speeches to junior and senior high school students through a school visitation program that was launched by her office in October 2018. Mrs. Minnis is also the founder of the Women's and Girls Membership Coalition, which main goal is training and funding for mentors. Mrs. Minnis is also a strong advocate of health, nutrition, and wellness, and can be seen daily working out at a local gym. She is a marathon runner, having participated in local and international races for many years. She is a proud mother and grandmother who is deeply committed to the development of young girls and women. This passion led her to become one of the founding members of the Ladies' Chambers, a community-based program established in Nassau in 2012. Lastly, Mrs. Minnis has completed training for the practice of real estate and currently manages her real estate empire in the Bahamas. She is an avid reader and a member of the local Grace Community Church, a non-denominational Christian church in the Bahamas. Mrs. Minnis is the wife of the Most Honorable Dr. Hubert A. Minnis, Prime Minister of the Commonwealth of the Bahamas. And we are indeed honored to have her join us on this occasion. Welcome, Mrs. Minnis.
Thank you so much. Hearing my bio, I hardly know that person, but I'd like to say my best feature, in my opinion, is being a grandmother to two. But ladies, the honor is all mine to be a part of this meeting this morning. I myself have been in agriculture for 36 years after being a former school teacher. But agriculture is still dear to my heart. First, I was a food microbiology, just working closely with our local cottage industry. So I spend many times with especially women who had a vibrant cottage industry in the Bahamas at one point, then becoming in the area of food policy and standard. I was the representative with Codex, and I worked along with projects with the FAO. So I am no stranger to the rural and to agriculture as a whole. So in extension, I am one of you, quite understanding of what happens with rural women in agriculture and agriculture on a whole. Today, I'm here to salute all of you for the work you continue to do in providing food security in your various countries. And so, ladies, I truly salute you. And I'm certain that during this time of the pandemic, many households, because as they were locked down here in the Bahamas and perhaps in your country, and were staying at home, they started home gardens. And from that, I am hearing many people are now convinced that that is the way to go, that it helps in the household food security, and it also lends a way of having some income or not having to expend so much of your income. In the stores. The Department of Agriculture here in so much has now launched a backyard gardening program in many of the communities. And here in my community, we have even had it extended to contests. So many people are doing the backyard gardening at this time. And so you ladies, we see not only to do your value added in the processing your products, the way Martha has done a lot of her work is in the and value added onto your products because it gives you more financial stability. In July, the Women Girls Mentoring Coalition, for which I'm a founder, put on a processing class for over 35 young women and girls, which went so well that many of them are calling to further their studies in this area and hoping to become have many cottage industry themselves. So I truly congratulate all of you because many of our communities and many of our women in these communities would not be able to keep themselves and have financial stability for their homes without you women in agriculture. Here in the Bahamas, we see that we have many of our women who are doing production, who's gone into production of herbs and spices and who are doing the agriculture. And so I congratulate you again. I ask you to continue the work that you're doing. I know that AICA, FAO, and many of the agricultural organizations and programs are there to assist you. As said, I am a part of SCLAN, which is Spouses of Caribbean Leaders Association. And we are now in Jamaica, Grenada, we have, and many of the other Caribbean countries. So if we can help you, and if I can help anybody here in the Bahamas through the SCLAN program, we would be happy to. Don't feel free to contact me at the Office of the Spouse. I am in the Foreign Affairs Ministry, and many of you through your spouse's program, you should be able to ask and get assistance. And so thank you very much for having me, and I hope you have a very fruitful meeting. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mrs. Minnis, for your encouraging words, and I'm sure it has resonated with the participants. Coming right now to bring us remarks and to speak to what they are doing is Ms. Kelly Fitjames. And before she comes, I will just tell you a little about her. Kelly Fitjames was born in the United States, but has been living in Brazo Seco, Bahia, a rural rainforest community in Trinidad's Northern Range since 1998. Kelly has been a part of many community groups over the years, but is a director and founding member of the Alliance of Rural Communities since 2014. Kelly is a mother of two teenagers, loves hiking and camping in the forest, and has also been spending these last years learning about and working on her own anti-racism development. Welcome, Kelly.
Hi, thank you very much. I am just gonna wait on my slides. Because of my internet connection, I'm not able to share my screen and be part of Zoom. So I have sent the slides to be shown. While we're waiting, I don't know if it's possible. I see that there was a request for people to kind of say who they are and where they're from. I find the Zoom conferences sometimes challenging because I'm watching the screen of black boxes with names and my face. So here's my presentation coming up. Okay.
Can so, I see the screen? Sorry.
I'm seeing my presentation. Is everybody else seeing it?
Yes, I'm seeing it. Thanks.
Okay, great. So I just wanted to give a little background of the organization that I am part of here in Trinidad. We're called the Alliance of Rural Communities, and our focus really is community resilience and systemic change. And how we have gone about that is using chocolate making as the vehicle for that. So can we go to the next slide, please? Right, so our mission of where the periphery becomes the center, it was really focused on rural communities, but today, obviously, I will highlight the women that are involved with ARC. And as much of the time where rural communities are on the periphery and not seen as the integral part of the center, so too can that be true of women and of the, you know, patriarchal version, cultural version that might say that men are who are at the center, when we all very much know that nothing would be happening in the center without the women. And same is true with rural spaces and rural communities, that all of our, the essential elements that make urban centers function is because of what comes from rural spaces. So that really is, ARC's mission is really empowering and bringing the focus back to who is making things function, which are really rural spaces and of course the women in these spaces. Next slide. So what we are doing is going into rural space, in this case with chocolate, where the cocoa is growing, and teaching these communities to make the very end value added products. So in this case, the chocolate. So this is about community owned businesses using their own local resources to be the ones that are revolutionizing the way business and production and development can happen. So in this picture, these are two young women, and these are our current chocolate makers in Brazos Seco. Next slide. Where we are functioning currently is in, obviously we're based in Trinidad, so we have three groups in Trinidad that are community-owned chocolate companies, and one in Tobago. And then we also have two groups in St. Lucia that we have supported and facilitated, and one in Guyana. Next slide. And just a little bit on our structure. We started as an NGO, and that the idea was to do training, go into communities, train them how to make the chocolates, and let them run their own companies. But from that, we realized that we needed another arm, which is now ARC Enterprises, which would be the arm to really support these companies once they are fully functional, they are making their own products, but to do the sales and distribution outside of their communities, there needed to be a support group to make that happen. So we formed ARC Enterprises as basically a distribution company for anything happening outside of communities. And all of this is in support of ARC conservation, which is, you know, our whole model is that triple bottom line of people, planet, profit, with profit being the last of our focus, people and planet being before that. And so our conservation is an NGO focused on community-led conservation, because of course, in the communities we are interacting with, they are in a rainforested area, a secluded beach area, in areas that have a lot of ecology to be conserved and preserved. Next slide. So one of the focuses of how we have done development through ARC is understanding that all of these rural spaces need income revenue generating opportunities. It's one of the biggest challenges in rural spaces, and I'm sure that's true in all spaces around the world, not just in Trinidad, not just in the Caribbean. And so in order to do any sort of transformative work, we knew part of what needed to happen was not just getting money there, which could come through grants or other kind of funding, but actually creating business opportunities so that the communities themselves would be the ones doing the revenue generation. So the way that it is happening now is income is earned through chocolate sales, through chocolate tourism, which of course has been dramatically, both of those things have been dramatically affected and decreased during COVID time. But because we had already also included things of purchasing produce from the same cocoa farmers who, you know, cocoa estates are polyculture food forests, so it's not just cocoa. We also do a delivery service and system. So we have been able to, during COVID, still create employment by increasing the amount of produce deliveries we do and by increasing the amount of processed and catered products we do with that produce. And basically what it's allowed is these same young women who were the chocolate makers are now making bammies and eggplant pâtés and different processed items that can be using the products from the community still, but that are more sort of essential services that people are looking for as opposed to at this moment. Next slide. Right, so just that, you know, that's a bit of the background of ARC in general. And then just to speak specifically to the idea of this meeting with the women in ARC is just acknowledging the realities that we all know of what is happening in, again, across the world. But, you know, it's single parents, it's a lot of young parents, young women with children. And so what are the ways that we can create systems and opportunities that will facilitate the reality of their life? So one of the things is having this company run within their community. It's in a room in the community center. It means they can walk to work. It means they can bring their children, because we've also created sort of child-friendly environments where people understand they can bring the kids. There's, instead of getting paid by the hour, they might get paid by the task. So even though they bring their child, which might mean it takes them longer to get things done, they still get paid for what they do. And the hours can be flexible based on what is needed to be done and what their other commitments are. So there's just ways that don't allow young mothers to thrive in corporate situations that we can modify and work with the reality. And another thing is we do a lot, almost all of our communication is through online documents and Google documents, Google Sheets. And so that can all happen from home. Anybody who's doing data entry, once they have some kind of device and internet, it could happen from their house. They could go by somebody else who will watch the child while they do it. They could come to the room where we have internet. So there's just options. And it's a key element, I think, of obviously supporting women to be and stay involved. Next slide. Right, and another thing, the women on the left, the on the far left, is myself, and then I'm Wendy is in the middle and Yvonne on the right with the orange shirt. And what Yvonne and Wendy, they're both, all of us are in our 40s, and what we all knew of being involved was as soon as we learned something, we wanted to train young women. So the young women on the right are three young women from the Grand Rivière community who are all in their early 20s, and that's been the immediate succession planning of anybody as we're training is to train the next generation. So as soon as we learn something, we're training somebody else. And it really facilitates the young women getting involved. It's happened in all aspects of data entry, of chocolate making, and even with the farming as well. So next slide. And what it has meant is this young woman on the left is Melissa. She's actually the manager of the Brasso Seco Chocolate Company. She's now 21. She was started with us when she was about 17. And this is her son on the right, Levi. And that's what it has. It really has been a success story in showing once things have the once there is facilitation and provisions for supporting young mothers, they can still stay involved. And what we see for sure is that these young mothers also see the potential for growth for a future for their children or their nieces or their nephews, because they see the possibility of a job, of, you know, they are experiencing it and they're seeing it for their children. Next slide. And then, I mean, we're talking about women in agriculture, and it's just one of those things that there is stigma. And as we heard in the beginning, you know, COVID has definitely shifted some of that stigma to say, oh, we really should be all doing a little more planting and all being really grateful for those who are doing agriculture and providing us with this essential service of food. But just by having a group within these communities that is not just supporting farmers, but really modeling farmers and excited about the farmers. And of course, you know, a lot of farmers are men, but there are women as well. And what it also, what we have seen is, you know, daughters whose dad has been the agriculturalist and they've always maybe shied away from it because maybe it's a man thing, or maybe it's not a glamorous thing, or it's not a desired thing to be doing, because we are in there and being really excited about all these amazing farmers, you know, we're seeing more young women feeling more comfortable and excited about being involved with the agricultural aspect of things, in addition to the processed part of things too. So it's been a definite shift in cultural acceptance and excitement about the essential nature and of farmers and of farming. Next slide. I think it might be the last one, actually. Ah, yes, right. So starting them young is just, you know, I think I'm sure I'm preaching to the choir here. I mean, it's a whole set of women who are doing this work. So I know that we all know a lot of these things, but it's good to remind ourselves. So these on the left, these are school children, which we made sure to make chocolate bar. Our chocolate bars are out of their price point, but we made sure to make small chocolates that are a dollar each that they could come and they could buy and they could, they all started, all of these young women now have graduated high school. Some of them have become, the smallest one there who's holding the biggest piece of chocolate has become a chocolate maker. And that's what it's allowed them to do, just by having access to the chocolate room, by buying it, by tasting it, by getting to come and wrap a bar. They've been involved in the process and seen the possibility for a while. Similarly, taking them to, on the right is, you know, an event we had selling chocolate and talking about the process. And we always would invite and allow the opportunity for any of the young women to join us and be part of that and get that exposure and opportunity. And even if it's just because they, you know, get a picture in the paper, but that in and of itself is exciting. So, you know, part of it is that is having the excitement of a project, the excitement of an opportunity that is different and outside of what they might have had exposure to. So I think the last slide. Yeah, you can go to, yeah, right. So this is just my contact information. Again, I'm Kelly. This is my contact both for phone and WhatsApp and our email and our Facebook and Instagram spaces. So I would really encourage and invite anybody here to follow us, see what we're doing, reach out to us. We are all about collaboration and understanding that none of this is happening because we've figured out something on our own. It's all about what we've learned from others and support we've received from others. So I think as women, we know that very well too, that the ability to create networks and foster networks and support is a key element to success and sustainability of these organizations and projects and plans. I would very much welcome any kind of questions. We could probably come out of these slides.
Could we just hold the questions for the end of all of the presentations, please? And you can also feel free to make your comments in the chat.
Yeah, sure, no problem.
Okay, we'd like to thank Ms. Carmen for Kelly for that presentation. And coming up next, we will have a presentation by Ms. Carmen Nurse, who is actually the president of the Caribbean Network of Rural Producers. Before she comes, I would just state that Ms. Carmen was born in Guyana and now resides in St. Lucia. She is a teacher by profession at the McCood Secondary School in St. Lucia. She was educated at the University of Guyana in the area of secondary education and teaching. She is a member of the McCood cluster of the St. Lucia Network of Rural Women Producers and is the president of the Caribbean Network of Rural Women Producers, of which the Bahamas chapter is a member. One of the flagship activities of the cluster is the production of chocolates. Carmen is a key player in this venture. So without any further ado, we look forward to Carmen's presentation at this time.
Good morning to all. And let me say thanks to Ms. Liebert for the brief introduction. I would like also at this time to acknowledge the presence of Mrs. Patricia Minnis, spouse of the Prime Minister of Bahamas and the Commonwealth, and the ECO representative, and all the members in the audience today. It is indeed a great pleasure on behalf of the Caribbean Network of Rural Women Producers, and especially now the St. Lucia Network of Rural Women Producers, to submit this presentation. I will now share my screen with you. Women empowering women. That by itself should bring a smile on our face. What we can do if we collaborate, how much we can transform lives. Coming just after Kelly, who shared on the ARC network, this is also a key representation of what sharing can produce. But before I get into the chocolate section, I just want to give a brief overview on the Caribbean Network of Rural Women Producers. As we are called in the abbreviation, CANROP, presently we are in 10 countries, active, but this here is a form of networking, the type of networking that we are hoping to produce. The ARC is not part of CANROP, but it shows that we need not just members within CANROP to support us, but those outside. Their focus is on rural development, and that is what CANROP is all about, rural development. Brief history on CANROP. And it's good to know that Miss Minnis is here with us, because the genesis of Canorup was actually started among the wives of the ministers of head of states. So while they were out, while the husbands were out attending meeting, the wives were within communities creating such network. So the regional network, which is a nonprofit organization, was launched in 1999 to create a single entity with existing association of rural producers. We are also networking. We are part of the Alliance for Sustainable Development of Agriculture and Rural Milieu, and the Alliance is supported by the offices of the Inter-American Institute for Cooperation on Agriculture in Caribbean. ICA has, in the Caribbean, has become synonymous also with Canorup, because where there is an ICA office, they are fully supportive of Canorup. And for that, we continue to be grateful. Our mission, and what we are doing here is fulfilling our mission, is to promote and support the efforts of the national chapters to modernize, train, and inform the chapter members to achieve sustainable small and micro enterprises development and rural prosperity by regional networking of traditional knowledge. Regional networking. And that's what we are doing presently. And that is what, in a short while, I will show the benefit of regional networking. All right, so I'm home now. St. Lucia Network of Rural Women Producers. We are four clusters located in four different districts. We have the Babineau cluster, and the Babineau cluster, as we see, is in craft farming and agro-processing. The Mikut cluster, we are similar, same areas of interest. We have the Ansquet crafters, they are just doing craft only, and the Cannibal cluster, that they are involved in soap making, but together we operate as one. Things change for us in Mikud. On the 16th of October 2017, when the ARC decided through the initiative of ICA to collaborate with us to teach us chocolate production. Everything about chocolate production, the thing that we have been buying, we have been importing, and look as though it's so technical, it's impossible for rural people to produce such. The ARC made the difference. They made it what looked as though it was impossible to produce. They simplified it, and they were willing to show us how to make it. We were amazed that within 4 days of training, we were able to produce chocolate. Our facilitator then, the woman you're seeing in the video, Miss Jillian Gallard and her spouse, they came up here and spent 4 days and revolutionized chocolate production for the Mikul cluster. Not just that, and that's what we do. They invested in us, not just knowledge, but they provided the initial equipment and materials needed for the startup program. And sometimes we may look at location and say, we don't have the space, or we're thinking later. They came, and there's a saying that do not despise small beginnings. There was not an appropriate facility that had been needed AC for the final part of the production. But I'm also the president of the women's ministry of my church, and the production of chocolate in Mikud started at my church at Faith Tabernacle in Mikud. So that's what our starting point. But we have now gone over the government facility that they have given us for their production. All right. Within 4 days, the things that we have learned, the things that we did, testing of cocoa beans to identify the flavor. We learned then that beans from different areas, just because of the soil type, will produce different flavors. Then we were told how to taste chocolate, not to chew chocolate, but to suck, you know, to let it melt in your mouth and to get the full taste of it. So that testing was done. They brought samples of chocolate from Trinidad and we went through the testing. We were able to, prior to coming, we were told to get fermented beans, cocoa beans. We had that ready. They brought some and we had some. And so we tasted the raw beans. We were told how to ferment, the process of fermenting the beans. Then we had the grinding of it, after roasting, the grinding and the widowing of it to get rid of some of the shell content of it. We use our conger to grind the sugar, the fat, and so forth. Then we had the tempering, the molding, the packaging, the pricing, and marketing, all within 4 days. Really a crash course, for which we welcome. The ingredients for the chocolate production is basically the cocoa, and again, collaboration, sugar, and the choice of sugar, the demerara sugar, and the demerara sugar, based on information received, because of the crystal grains, they are more uniform, so we are using the demerara sugar, so we have Guyana in St. Lucia, but fortunately, the sugar is sold in St. Lucia, but the fat, the cocoa fat, which is not available here, we are still buying from the ARC. We are still buying from Trinidad. They have the facility that's producing the natural fat. We are not looking at anything synthetic, and so we have it. The chocolate is, as I mentioned earlier, is dark chocolate. So for persons who have lactose intolerance, you can use the chocolate, our chocolate, because it has no milk, no milk. This was just a startup to show when the end product of our item or forest set, what they look like. We were looking at the sheet, we were looking at the glaze, we were looking at those with rough surface. They say, well, this cannot be used. We have to retemper it. We have to redo it. Is that when it is it's not good, we can retemper it. And we have grown to the extent that we are not retempering only if we realize that we are getting some trouble, because that's the more technical side of it. We are now using it to make our local cocoa bars. We are putting it in block form and we are now selling that as one of our byproducts since we have gone into the chocolate production. We have, as a result of our production, we have registered the business Miku Chocolate Network Inc., because the network is a not-for-profit. And here we are looking at economic empowerment. We are looking at paying people. We are looking at finding salaries. And so we have moved it into a business arena. And so we have done sampling. We have done community sales. We have done marketing. Our biggest market right now in St. Lucia is the Massey stores, all the agents in St. Lucia we are supplying. We have tourist shops to different tourist locations. And we have persons buying from us directly from the factory. So we have factory price and we have outdoor price. They are looking at 3% of cocoa. We have what we call the 60%, which means that it has 60% of the beans and 40% of the ingredients, which will be the sugar and the fat. We have the 70% and we have the 80%, all dark chocolate. The darker the chocolate, the richer it is. And so we have been doing very well in our sales thus far. And as if sometimes we look for the involvement of government at different levels, this photo here represents our Minister of Education, who's also Minister for Gender Affairs, and she has been our top promoter of our chocolate. Wherever she goes, it has gone global by the ministry and the different government places, just using it as tokens for giving to their representative and for the foreign diplomats as they come, we can guarantee an order for our product. Now, expanding capacity. The Alliance has done exactly that. They have empowered us and the St. Lucia Network, St. Lucia chapter can boast of an economic empowerment as a result of our involvement and continued involvement with the Alliance. And as Kelly's on board, we are right now, we are short for fat, and this is a time when we are looking at Christmas, the demand for Christmas packages, local and for overseas. So we are presently, and Kelly is listening to me, presently in need of some fat. So we need to see how quickly we can ship that to St. Lucia. So we're way forward. Through the technical intervention of AICA funding for the 2014 we had funds to complete this. Sorry, that was not the that should not have been shown. One minute, that should not have been shown. All right, so the way forward, we are looking right now at international markets. We have started the process of becoming get ISO trained so that our product can now go global because we are not prepared to stay where we are. We are looking to go to the next level. And so we are hoping that in 2021, that we'll be able to market our product. And the last slide is not there. And in closing, I just want to say thank you. I want to say thank you for their time and have a Merry Christmas. Thank you. So thank you very much for the time, and I'm free for any questions at the end.
Okay, thank you, Ms. Carmen, for that very informative and motivational presentation. We thoroughly enjoyed that and look forward to the questions and comments that will be following. Our next presenter will be Mrs. Martha Hanna-Smith, who serves as the president of our local chapter of Bangrock. Mrs. Smith is a former educator and also a former president of the Bahamas National Craft Association. She presently serves as the president of Bangrock, which is the Bahamas Network of Rural Women Producers, and she is a go-getter. She keeps them active and always looking for opportunities that will benefit the local persons involved in many sectors. She has also served as the vice president of the Caribbean Network of Rural Producers and has participated in many of their workshops throughout the region. She is also very instrumental in the training of youth. That's her passion. She looks for opportunities to involve them across many, many programs during the summer and also in schools and throughout the various family islands where she has established clusters. So we look forward at this time to hearing from Miss Martha Smith.
Okay. Talk and then press. Okay.
Press this. Hi, good morning. I'm not sure if something is wrong on my end. Oh, Martha, okay.
Good morning. Good morning.
Good morning, we can hear you.
Great. Okay, I would like to acknowledge the presence of the spouse of our Prime Minister of the Commonwealth of the Bahamas, Mrs. Patricia Minnis. And Dr. Higgins, also by ICA representatives, Mr. Alistair. I am about to give you my presentation. Topic is women, empowering women economically. All right, I'm going to give you a brief history of Banrop. Banrop was formed in 2014 under the Exuma Crafters Network in Ruleville, Exuma. It was a recipient of an $85,000 grant awarded by the UN Women and written and managed by the Inter-American Institute for Cooperation and Agriculture in the Bahamas. Ms. Lightburn has a lot to do with this. The network was formed to assist women throughout the Bahamas create better lives for themselves and their families. The Women of Banrop Network, with other women nationally in the region, and also the same form of trainings offered. In a photo, you'll see Vice President Emily Ramming and her executive team. All right, Banrop consists of 25 women with diverse backgrounds, including farmers, handicrafts, business administrators, and food processors. Banrop can now boast of having clusters on the islands of North and South Andros, Exuma, and Cat Island. We are not like St. Lucia. Miss Carmen, nice, the president, she can say they have different clusters on one mass land. But we will have to travel in order to form clusters. So I'm happy to report that we have made some efforts to form those clusters. All right, Banrop's purpose, to empower women through education, training and cultural exchange. Also to allow members to pool their resources for the marketing of their products. Meet our executive team. President, yours truly. Vice President, Shima Darling. Secretary, Shannon Fountain. Treasurer, Donnelly Burrows. Directors, Patrice Green, Dr. Eurecia Hepburn, Ginny McKinney, Rosamid Curling, Ruth Forbes, your moderator, and Vivian Miller. produced and sold by members. Bush teas, face masks, bottled tomatoes, soaps, jewelry, clothes, floral arrangements, and many others. Jams, pepper sauces, tamarind sauces, sea salt, honey, eggs, vegan dishes. And of course, at our farmers market on Saturdays, we have great presents, young and, I mean, middle age at these markets. So they go and they set up and sell their produce. Carving Week of our culture, some of the activities we would have participated in. We went to Barbados and we represent the Bahamas at the Carving Week of our culture by displaying our products. And if you can see clearly, those of you who know the minister, he's in one of our photos, right? The Minister of our culture and marine resources for the Bahamas, the Honorable Michael Pinkler. Kenrop training sessions with Aika, and we can see in the photo, Aika Director General, Dr. Manuel Terio. Okay, we also produce onion flakes, pepper sauces, and this is one of our main products. We also did bottled tomatoes, seasoned and unseasoned. Members are allowed one day per week to make use of the food lab to create their products. And we say thank you to Mr. Pete Daly. I think he is in the room. Thanks to him, he's a senior technology and also his staff. North Andres cluster, of course, the training that we did, they made soaps. Unfortunately, we don't have that photo. South Andres, they were trying to send us a video. We're not getting that to open with their jam making. So these are the training that they had. Tania taught preschool. Mrs. Green and I, we visited at school on many occasions for the purpose of setting up and maintaining school garden. Also, we did soap making with the teachers. We display our products at the National Day of the Girl Child, organized by the Office of the Spouse of the Prime Minister of the Commonwealth of the Bahamas and Mrs. Anne Higgins, Assistant and Program Specialist. This event took place at Government House, and of course, in one of the photos, you can see the Governor General, he visited our booth. In 2019, we conducted our first summer camp. We spoke about it for a long time, but I always say it's a time for everything. So it happened. The second one is this year, of course, we could not meet. So we did it virtually. We tried anyhow. And some sessions, practical, were done in baking, basic baking. Our trainings offered by Banrop, you've heard before, soap making, traditional planning, sewing, shell craft, straw craft. Now, Banrop initiative. We were able to participate in the food processing workshop for the girls, Women and Girls Coalition, organized again by the spouse of the Prime Minister of the Commonwealth of the Bahamas. And I'm thinking that, like she said, more of this type of training will be done in the future. And the training provided the participant with entrepreneurial skills for life. And of course, they are now able to set up small businesses. These skills are especially useful during this pandemic season when the Bahamas is experiencing a difficult time economically. COVID-19 effects has caused a change in the normal way of life globally. Life is no longer as usual. Thousands of people are out of work. Despite this, creative thinking must be our focus so that our products will be marketable. Many women who said they could not do a particular job, for example, cook a particular dish and make breads, they are now making an income from these. COVID-19 can be seen as a blessing in disguise. The Bahamas is rich in its natural resources that need to be tapped into. Let us get up and be movers and shakers to get some things done. All of our natural resources, let us look at all the bushes, we say bushes in the Bahamas, that we have out there. For example, in every yard, I feel they should have a moringa tree. Even if people would go and collect those fruits and sell the fruits, even if you save 15 cents each, that's some income coming in. You're not working, so something coming in. So let's tap into our natural resources. In 2021, Bandrock members will continue to provide opportunities for its members and other women to empower them economically as well as to strive. Two, we're going to try as hard as we can to get all women involved, not only our members, but women everywhere. And of course, members of other chapters in the Caribbean, they can feel free if they need our assistance to call on us. We anticipate setting up backyard farming, and we're going to utilize our experienced farmers within the group. Now, I noticed that Ms. Whitley Miller is present here. So be ready, Mrs. Whitley Miller. When you call upon, you are our experienced farmer in that group, and also affiliate Dawkins and others. As more local products will now be in demand, we must be ready to supply. Get those products ready. Our pepper sauce, we have to do as many cases as we can. And please be informed that we are now having our labels done professionally. Also, we are having our logo. We're redesigning our logo. And we are going to provide stickers for our members who will use the stickers, Bandrock stickers, to place on their goods. And this will signify that these are quality products. Okay, of course, with the labels, IECA and the FAO, they've provided some funds. So they are responsible for getting our labels and our logo done. Thanks to them. All right, this is the end of my presentation, but I really want to touch on just a few of the things that we can get into, more things that we can get into for this pandemic season. I'm thinking that those people who have nothing to do, why not go and collect some plants? You don't have to pay for them, they are free of charge. Collect some plants, wash them carefully, and you make some teas. Bottle them. If you need bottles, I can give you some bottles so you can at least market them. So that would be a start. You'd have some income, and then you can go further into it, and you can decide to do some tea, herbal tea bags. Whatever you need, as long as we can help you, Bandrock is here. And we are also looking for new members. Okay, we have some fresh blood here, as they usually say, some young members to get in there and get things shaking and moving. So I thank you for your attendance and also your presence. And we look forward to have more of these webinars series in the upcoming year. Thank you. Okay, ladies and gentlemen, I think that we have had much food for thought and some provocative information was shared to whet your appetites to explore other opportunities in becoming further empowered and for persons who are thinking to become involved in some sort of enterprise. So we are pretty much on target, and right now we will open the lines for questions or comments from participants at this time. So you can unmute your mic if you would wish to question and have it directed to one of the speakers in particular, or just to have someone answer who may be best suited to do so. So we are now opening for questions and comments. Okay, you can raise your hand in the chat as well. Okay, meanwhile, we're reviewing the comments in the chat just to see if there are any specific questions at this time.
Hi, good morning.
Good morning once again, Mr.
I'm trying to raise my hand, but I'm now seeing the option. Sorry. I have a question. Can I ask my question?
Yes, go ahead.
I welcome the presentation by the Alliance of Rural Communities as well as the one for St. Lucia. And I see a direct partnership in terms of the chocolate making. And I'm wondering what timelines and costs would be associated with doing a similar type of activity. And this is for Kelly, for a country like St. Vincent. How can we explore something like that in neighboring St. Vincent to Trinidad and St. Lucia? I don't know if you all were able to get my question. Sorry.
I heard the question. Are you hearing me?
I'm hearing you. Thank you.
Okay, great. My video is not turning on right away, but there is a whole, I honestly don't remember the budget, right? But I would have it in a document somewhere. And basically the budget that we did for the St. Lucia project was through ICA, and was the paying the trainer to come, Jillian and her partner to come and do that 4-day training that Ms. Nurse spoke about, and then the purchasing of the equipment. And the thing about the way ARC envisions a lot of our
are you done with your comment, please? Hello?
Are there any other comments on that point or any other questions at this time for us? Unfortunately, the audio dropped.
I just want to intervene here and mention that our present chocolate is called Miku chocolate, because everything of it is from Miku in terms of the labor, in terms of the sourcing of the beans, the workforce, and everything is Mikun. But the intention is this to go forward, to train others in different districts. So it will not remain, we will identify the Mikun, as I said, flavors in different soil places are different. So we are presently in Mikun, but we are hoping in 2021 that we will have also a Babano brand, because we are anticipating a big international market. And if we team up together, then we'll be empowering more women to get involved. I must also sanction at this time, for instance, we have one student who comes after school to help with the packaging. She is fully aware of the process. We can need her to do certain processing. And so she end up having finances to help with our schooling. So that's the aim as we go along, to share. And as Kylie also mentioned, that's our succession plan, to get the young ones involved. We have the young ones also involved in marketing, in terms of taking it and distributing the products upon the order. So we have them also involved in that process. So that I would like to add to what Alistair mentioned, or upon his request.
Good morning. My name is Ophelia Dawkins. I'm a farmer.
Can you turn on your video, please, Miss Ophelia?
I thought it was on. It appears to be on.
Now, yes, thank you.
My name is Ophelia Maycock. I'm Dawkins. I'm from the Bahamas. I'm a small farmer and I'm experiencing an issue. This has nothing. I enjoy everything, the talk of the chocolate making and all that. Make me wish I could actually make some chocolate here. But I have a problem with, I have a large amount of cucumber, and apparently the market seem to be saturated at this time. Are there anyone with any pointers as to anything that you can make with cucumber other than salads and pickles? Hello?
Okay, in response, I'm a food and nutrition teacher, and I also, that's my private product. I also use it to make drink, what I call cucumber cool. So it's a very nutritious drink. It's
Can you turn your video on, please?
Sorry, yeah. I also use it, you said relish, because I was just going to tell you that it's very good, especially this season, for making relish, cucumber relish. But I also have a product I call cucumber cool. It's a cucumber drink, which is very, very nutritious, healthy in terms of even for workers in industry and so forth. It is detoxing. And because of the other ingredient, the main ingredient is cucumber, but it's just about two other additional ingredients. So maybe we can speak after through matter. We can have a discussion.
I would appreciate that very much, because I've also tried the cucumber drink. Apparently, it's not sweet enough. I tried selling it at the market and it's not sweet enough, so not too many people were buying it.
If I may interject, I'm Denise Morrell from Nassau, Bahamas, and I would be happy to purchase some cucumbers from you, because we use them in some of our products.
Could you just hold a minute, please? We have a bit of interruption. The others mute their mics while Ms. Morrell is speaking. Thank you.
Thank you. So I was saying that I would be happy to purchase some of your cucumbers from you, and you may contact us at www.naturallybahamian.com, or you may call me at 557 557-5270. Thank you. And thank you, ladies, for your contribution. I really enjoyed listening to you today.
Great. Could you please put your contact information in the chat for reference, Ms. Worrell? Okay, are there any more questions or general comments as we move to wrapping up, please? Okay, if there aren't any more further comments or questions, indeed, I would like to thank all of the persons who have, okay, I see Mr. Alistair has just raised his hand.
Sorry to come back in again, Madam Moderator. I just want to apologize for the absence of one of our presenters, Ms.
Please turn on your video, Alistair.
Yeah, I want to apologize for the absence of one of our colleagues, Ms. Lieuw-A-Soe from Suriname. Again, I should apologize to everyone. We unfortunately placed the wrong time for Suriname that clashed with a pre-existing activity on her part, and she was not able to stick around to the end. However, what we would want to propose is that we can do a follow-up forum in the new year when things have settled down a bit, and where we can focus primarily on the work that is taking place out of Suriname, as well as probably Guyana. So we'll look at the Southern Caribbean in our next intervention. So, and this is something that is driven by the women of CANROC. So we'll be guided by Mrs. Nurse and her colleagues in terms of when they would want to have another forum. So I just wanted to put that on the table. For those, I know a lot of people have been messaging me and asking me about it. So I just want to clarify that. Again, we had a little mishap, miscommunication, and at the next forum, we'll surely have Suriname doing the presentation. Thank you.
Mr. Hewish, can I follow up briefly? Please, Chair.
Sorry?
Can I follow up briefly? Just asking the Chair.
Could you turn your video on, please, as you speak?
Yes, my video is on.
If you can speak a little louder, though, I didn't hear you.
Yes, I just said I just wanted to follow up on the comment you made, just briefly. Can I go ahead?
Madam Moderator?
Go ahead, please. We have a minute.
Yes, thank you. Alistair, just to follow up on what Alistair said, unfortunately, Tania had making it the FAO. But she did indicate that you're going to have a follow-up event. That one would be more geared towards actual engagement. Like I see, we already started some engagement with some of the women requesting potential solutions. So the next forum will be geared directly in delving a little more in detail with some of the how to replicate some of the initiatives that from one country to another. So I guess in the new year, we will take it up a little more of that. There are also a number of important initiatives that I think that would be useful to share. The group that Tanya is president of, they have established a very large agro-processing plant, very impressive. They have also established cassava fields and a number of other initiatives. There are a number of new labels that they have developed, and they have opened up the market in Holland. So there are a lot of initiatives that can be shared so that the women from the other chapters could see the possibilities that if we continue to work together, what possibilities there are for strengthening and ensuring the economic empowerment of women. So I think in the new year, we could have that discourse again and look at a suitable date for a follow-up meeting. That one would be more of the practical elements of how to get there, how to achieve similar success in the various countries. Thank you very much.
Okay, thank you,
Madam Moderator. A quick follow-up comment. Dr. Denise, maybe you can identify yourself and see how we can get in touch with you.
Oh, but my name was on the screen. Sorry, that's why I didn't bother to identify. My name is Cadillis. I'm the ECA representative in Suriname, and I'm also the ECA Special Affairs Coordinator for the Caribbean region. I mean, you could get in touch with me via any one of the local offices in any one of the countries. If you need to speak specifically on any issue, just contact them and they will get in touch with me and we can take it from there. Some people that I already know, I got to say hello to Miss Ness, and many other colleagues I see in the group. So yeah, just contact the local offices and they will contact me and put me in touch with you.
Okay, thank you very much for that exchange. It was very useful and also sets the tone for follow-up going forward. At this time, we'd just like to pose a vote of thanks to the participants. Firstly, Mrs. Patricia Minnis, the spouse of Prime Minister of the Commonwealth of the Bahamas. Thank you very much for taking the time out to be with us here this morning. We'd like to thank Ms. Shakara Lightburn, our acting representative and national specialist for AICA in the Bahamas, for using her office to facilitate the work of Ban Repair in the Bahamas and also the agricultural sector at large. We thank Ms. Kelly Fitjames for her presentation from the Alliance of Rural Communities, and also Ms. Carmen Nurse, the president of CanRock, who gave us quite an insight into their operations. And of course, we like to thank Ms. Martha Smith, who is the president of BANROP in the Bahamas and the vice president of CanRock at the regional level. Okay, and we would like to just remind persons that if they want to contact the local chapter, they can contact the local IECA office. We are in collaboration with them for work on behalf of BANROP. And also, for the contact again for the office of the spouse, we would like to also have that contact posted in the group, but we can also serve as a conduit for persons who may have questions or concerns for Ms. Minnis in that capacity. So once again, we'd like to thank Mr. Alistair, who is the IECA's coordinator and specialist in international trade, for working with us to pull together this program for today. And on behalf of all of us here, we'd just like to extend season's greetings and a productive 2021 to one and all. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Bye.
Thank you.